God bless you. This is our new member orientation class number one, introduction to the Life Church and introduction to your pastor. This lesson is, again, just an opportunity for us to give you a brief history of myself as well as the history of Life Church so that you can have a better understanding of how we got to this point. Well, let's go back to how it all started. I was actually born in South Georgia in a city, a town called Waycross, Georgia. My mother, who we affectionately here at Life Church call Mom Foster, Mom became pregnant with me her senior year of high school, and consequently her plans for college were changed immediately. And she now began to focus on beginning to put together a life for not only herself, but for a newborn child. My father came to Atlanta, to Morehouse, to pursue his education. And Mom stayed in Atlanta, and along with her family, they took care of me for the first year of my life. And after that, my mom met who we call here Dad Foster. My father, he is my stepfather. He's not my biological father, but he has been in my life since I was 1 year old. And this is the only setting that you'll ever hear me refer to him as my stepfather, because he has been most present, since I was 1 year old. They got married, and my dad convinced my mother to move to Florida. He didn't want to raise his children. He didn't want to raise his family there in Waycross. And so he convinced my mom to move to Florida. Dad went ahead to a city called St. Petersburg, Florida, and he secured three things. He found a job, he found a home, and he found our church. And when he came back to Waycross to get us, took us to St. Petersburg, Florida, he took us to our own home, and he took us to our church. And that church would be the church in which I would grow up in, and they would remain members until we began Life Church in 2010. But that church, Pentecostal Temple Church of God in Christ, is responsible for my spiritual foundation. So much of what was planted and placed in me as a child took place there at Pentecostal Temple. And I am forever indebted to that church and to the individuals, the members who played such a vital role in me becoming who I am today. Early on, I was diagnosed as having a learning disability, and I was placed in what they referred to at that time, the slow learning class. And so for the first 2 years of my elementary school training, I was a part of the SLD program, or the slow learners program. And really, in retrospect, that really was almost like a daycare setting, that those students who were labeled slow were taken and taken aside, and we were pretty much entertained while the other students were learning. We played games, put puzzles together, nothing academically challenging, and consequently it caused us to even fall further behind. But at the age of 8, I gave my life to the Lord, and not only did he save me, but something triggered in me, and not long after that, I was taken out of the Slow Learners program, and I was placed back into the class with the other students. And God being the God that he is, he didn't just allow us to catch up with the other students, but by the time I was in the fourth grade, I was taking fifth grade classes, and in the fifth grade, they began testing me for the gifted program. And my sixth grade, there in the sixth grade, my first year of middle school, I was placed in the gifted program, and I remained in the gifted program until I graduated from high school. So you can see that I went from being labeled slow to being labeled gifted. And early on in my life, I experienced the power of God and what God can do. Again, taking me from being called slow to being gifted, to being in classes for entertainment, for pleasure, to being placed in challenging college-level courses while I was in high school. I ended up becoming the first black valedictorian of my high school. At that time, my high school was over 50 years old, and I became the first black to become the valedictorian of that high school. Not only was I named the valedictorian of my high school, but I was also named the top graduating male of all of the high schools in our county. So again, seeing what God did for my life in such a short period of time, going from slow to being gifted and graduating valedictorian of my high school. My senior year of high school, I had already secured a place at Emory University, had received a scholarship to attend Emory, and I was on my way to Atlanta, but to Emory University. My parents were convinced that they thought that I needed to attend a historically black college because they felt as if I needed what they referred to at the time was the black experience. I thought that I was having the black experience by the very fact that I was living in black skin, but they were convinced that I needed this black experience. I was not convinced, but they were. And they strongly encouraged me to attend an HBCU. I listened, but had no desire and no intentions on going to an HBCU. And they would periodically began this conversation and talking about how they thought that I needed this black experience. And after hearing it over and over again, I can remember after school one day while my mother was actually cooking in the kitchen preparing dinner, and she began to go on that discourse again about my need to attend a black college. And I thought I would put it to rest for the last time. It was around April of my senior year, knowing that most colleges had already accepted all of their freshman class, and definitely all of their scholarship funds had been distributed and allotted by that time. I decided that I would go and I would call Howard University just so they could tell me that they had already closed their freshman class for the upcoming year. I went into our family room and at the time picked up the phone and did what we did during that time. We didn't have Google, but we did have 411. I got called information and got the number for the admissions department of Howard University. I called and over the phone, I gave them a brief description of what I had accomplished, who I was, and over the phone, without anything in writing, without a formal application, anything to confirm what I was saying was true, the admissions director offered me a full expense academic scholarship to Howard University. Got all of my information, said they would be mailing all of the information to me, and I hung up the phone and I was the one that was surprised. I thought I was going to be able to tell my parents that I can't go to a HBCU because all of the freshman classes had already been closed for the coming year. But to my surprise, not only was it open, but I was again offered that full expense scholarship over the phone. I hung up and I did the same thing. I called 411 again, this time for the admissions department for Morehouse College. I called Morehouse's admissions department, and over the phone again, the admissions director offered me a full expense academic scholarship to Morehouse College. And now, within no doubt less than an hour, I am now holding two full expense scholarships, one to Howard University and one to Morehouse College. I eventually chose Morehouse College, and after graduating from high school, I came to Atlanta to attend Morehouse College. four of the most transformative years of my life. Besides Jesus, Morehouse has had such a tremendous impact on who I am today. There at Morehouse College, I was enrolled in the honors program and the pre-med program. While at Morehouse attending and pursuing my education, I began a Bible study as a result of the request of several students asking for me to start a Bible study there. We began a Bible study that began in one of our dorm rooms, and it grew until we had to move to our student government building. Not only were at that time that we have Morehouse students attending, but we also had students from Spelman as well as Clark University. God did some tremendous things while we were at Morehouse in that Bible study. Lives that were changed even to this day. Individuals who, even as they pursue their careers and have begun families and have blossomed in their lives, are still in love with the Lord and have a very fruitful relationship with the Lord that all began there on the campus of Morehouse College in that Bible study. Individuals were saved and filled with the Holy Spirit, introduced to the supernatural, and we saw miracles before our very eyes there on Morehouse's campus while we pursued our education. Not only did we pursue God, but we did pursue our education. I was inducted into Phi Beta Kappa, ended up graduating from Morehouse, Phi Beta Kappa, magna cum laude. I received two full expense scholarships to medical school, two of the top medical schools, not just in the country, but in the world. I received a full expense scholarship to Harvard's medical school, as well as Johns Hopkins Medical School. And there was a prophet who's still active in ministry today, Prophet Brian Mosley. I shared with him that I had these two scholarships and I was weighing them, and I didn't know exactly which one that I should accept. And Prophet Mosley encouraged me, said the Lord wanted me to go to Baltimore, that I was to go to Johns Hopkins School of Medicine. And I took the word of the prophet, and I went to Baltimore, and I attended Johns Hopkins School of Medicine, and continued my education. Once I got to Hopkins, it became a reality to me that I was having somewhat of an adjustment, having spent my earlier years of my education in a predominantly white environment. I'd gone to a predominantly black undergrad, and now I was back in a predominantly white environment. And I was having stress, a difficult time readjusting back into that environment. And it made my first year a little challenging, so much so that I considered leaving medical school and coming home. And one afternoon after I was done with my classes for the day, I called home just to test the ground to see how my parents would respond to the idea of me leaving medical school and coming home. And my father gave me some of the most powerful advice that I even yet glean from today. He told me, "Son, stay and finish, because if you don't finish, you'll get old and you'll have regrets." And from that phone call, hanging up with my parents and receiving that advice from my father, I stayed at Hopkins and I finished and got my degree, my medical degree, my doctorate in medicine. As I was getting closer to graduation, it became obvious to me that I did not want to spend the rest of my life taking care of sick people. Not because I did not have compassion, not because I did not care, but it became obvious to me that it was very difficult for me to unload, that I ended up carrying the pain of my patients. I still to this day remember the first patient who died that I took was taken care of. And so I did not know how I was going to be able to pursue a whole life of medicine and not being able to disassociate, disconnect from my patients. And so I began to look at other opportunities, other ways that I could take advantage and use my degree in medicine in pursuing other options as far as careers. And I, to this day, don't know where the idea came. It did not come from me. I know it had to have come from God, that the idea that I began to look at opportunities in the pharmaceutical industry. I was led to go ahead and send a letter of interest to all of the pharmaceutical companies to see what was available for an individual with my background. And I sent out, I remember, over 70 letters, because at that time there were so many small companies, and many of them were headquartered in New England, in the New Jersey area. But today we only have a few major companies because they've been consolidated. The smaller companies were bought out. But at this time, there were several, many companies. And again, I sent over 70 letters out to these different pharmaceutical companies to see what the opportunities that would be available for me. Out of all of those letters that were sent out, again, over 70, only one company responded. One company responded there in New Jersey. They responded and they offered to bring me to New Jersey. They wanted to interview me for a position that they had available in their medical department. I accepted the invitation, and again, they flew me to New Jersey, what was supposed to be an overnight trip. They flew me in one evening, that my interviews were first thing the next morning. I was to interview all day, and at the end of the day, I was to fly back to Baltimore. But after finishing all of the interviews that were scheduled, I got ready to close out with the HR director, and thinking that I'm getting ready to go back to the airport to fly back to Baltimore. And the HR director said, I need you to stay tonight, and I need you to stay because the president wants to interview you on tomorrow morning. And I was astounded. I was, again, not prepared to stay another day. But after hearing that the president wanted to meet with me and interview me on that next morning, I stayed. That next morning, I interviewed with the president. After the interview was finished, I went to the airport, flew back to Baltimore. And it was not until the day that I was graduating, I was getting ready to leave our apartment to go to the convention center where the graduation was going to take place. And all of my family is in town. It's an exciting time. They're getting ready to have their first doctor in the family. I'm getting ready to receive this degree that I had so sacrificed and worked so hard for. And I'm leaving the apartment. And as I'm leaving the apartment, the mailman is outside getting ready to deliver the mail. And as I'm walking out, he hands the mail to me. And in the mail, on the day that I am graduating, was an offer letter from the one company who responded to my letter, and the one company that offered me an interview for this position. I received an offer letter from that company for that position on the day that I'm getting ready to graduate. So not only am I graduating, but I now have the responsibility of to begin to get my family prepared that I will have a career, but my career would be somewhat different than they anticipated. That began another transition in my life. After finishing and graduating there at Hopkins, I left Baltimore and I went to Boston. Pursuing this new career, not having any idea how things were going to turn out. I had no one I could talk to because, again, this was uncharted territory that I was entering into. So much so that I was had already secured a spot in a hospital to pursue a residency in psychiatry. And I secured that spot there in Ohio, and I had to call the director of the psychiatry department to let them know that I would not be coming. And he informed me that he would not fill that position, but he would leave it open for an entire year. And if at any time in the year that I changed my mind and wanted to go back and continue to pursue practicing medicine, specifically a career in psychiatry, that I could go and just go to Ohio and that position would be there. He said there was nothing I would have to do, no paperwork, just show up, and again, that position, that slot would be held for me for one year. Needless to say, I never looked back. As I walked into this door, this uncharted door, this uncharted territory, it actually opened up opportunities for me that in retrospect, I know it was the Lord who was ordering my step. I had a very prosperous, successful, a rewarding career in the pharmaceutical industry. I was what they called at that time, I was placed on the fast track. And so I was being promoted and moved into different areas regularly as they were preparing me to continue to move up the ladder there in the company. It was around 2000 that I ran into one of the mission workers that were a part of the Church of God in Christ, in which I am a part of. And she invited me to come and visit the work that they were doing in Brazil. And I took that invitation and agreed to attend their convocation. Convocation was in July, and I went to their convocation, and I was amazed at what they were doing there in Brazil. The people embraced me, and that would begin another segment of in my life. I began to work in missions in the Church of God in Christ there in Brazil. I was later given a position as an overseer of the growth of the Church of God in Christ in northern Brazil. Northern Brazil is very unique because it's in northern Brazil where the slave trade took place. So many of the Africans would come from Africa to Brazil, and they would come into Brazil through northern Brazil. And so there was a large concentration of Afro-Brazilians there in North Brazil. And that's the area that I was given to grow the work of the Church of God in Christ. And I spent seven, almost 8 years working in missions there in Brazil and working as an overseer. I pastored other pastors. I was ordained, but I was not a pastor. I had not pastored myself, but I was in this role, I was pastoring other pastors. We started off, when I took the position, there were two churches in that area. And when I resigned from that position, that area had grown to 10 churches. Not only had we grown in numbers as far as the works, the number of churches, but we also had purchased the mother church there, the first church that was planted there in northern Brazil. So we worked there pastoring other pastors. I was licensed as a minister while at Morehouse. I was ordained as an elder my first year in medical school. So I have been actively a part of ministry all of my adult life. But I not only had I not pastored, but I had absolutely no desire to pastor. Everyone who knew me knew that I had no desire to pastor. I was happy assisting other pastors grow, maintain their churches, but I had no desire to pastor myself, not knowing that this experience in Brazil would be an experience that would literally move me and change my desires so my desires would line up with the will of God. And so there in Brazil, as I pastored other pastors, at this time, God was literally birthing a desire in me to pastor also. I was living in Washington, D.C. at the time, and I decided that I was doing a lot of real estate investment. I had a large portfolio of properties and multifamily properties, apartment buildings, I decided that I was going to purchase a home in Atlanta. Most of my family were in the South. I was the only one living up north there in Washington, D.C. So I said, I'll just go ahead and purchase a home, and that can be one day maybe my retirement home when I'm ready to retire. Not knowing that, again, all of this is in the plan of God, that God was literally getting ready to shift me from Washington to Atlanta. I found a home here in Atlanta, purchased that home, and again, yet living in Washington, D.C. And while I was here visiting in Atlanta and in devotion, I'll never forget it, while I was in prayer, I heard the Spirit of the Lord say to me, just a simple question. He said, if not now, then when? And that was the question that he asked me. And I knew exactly what he was asking. And I knew my response also. And in that moment, I said yes to the Lord. And after saying yes to the Lord and to what he was leading me to do, he began to give me details as far as what I was to do. After saying yes to the Lord, yes to this, to birthing, to planning a ministry, he began to give me the details. And this is what I was told, that I was to find a church building in the city of Atlanta. It could not be in the suburbs or the outskirts. It was to be in the city of Atlanta. And again, it was to be a church building, not a commercial building, not a storefront. It was to be a church building. And for 6 months, after securing a realtor, someone that I knew from the time that I was living here in college, we attended the same church, a realtor that eventually he and his family became a part of this ministry. But I secured him. We began to work together, trying to find the place where this ministry, Life Church, was to begin. And for almost 6 months, we looked and we looked and we looked, looking at church buildings in the city of Atlanta. Needless to say, in retrospect, how comical the experience was, as I would go into churches and speak to realtors and speak to pastors of the churches that were being sold. And they would begin to ask questions about the ministry that I had, and ask me how old was the ministry. And needless to say, the answer was, we haven't started yet. And how many members do we have? We don't have any members because we haven't started yet. And so when I would give these answers, many times almost to look like, you're not really serious. You don't need a church building. You haven't started anything yet. But again, I was obeying the word of the Lord. And so for 6 months, we looked. We finally found a church in Southwest Atlanta in a community called Adamsville. It was in the middle of a residential community. It was not on an expressway. It was not in an area where there was a lot of traffic or foot traffic. The only way really you could find it, you had to be looking for it or you had to be lost. But it was not just a church that was sitting in a location where you would just see it going to and fro. And it was a small church. The church had been renovated inside, needed some work aesthetically outside, but guess what? It was a church building. It was in the city of Atlanta. The pastor was retiring and getting ready. They were getting ready to sell the church. And at that time, his membership had pretty much become mainly his family. And he shared with me, whoever ends up purchasing this church, and if they are a part of the organization that I'm a part of, I'll just transfer my members, again, which mostly were his family, I'll transfer them over to the new pastor. And so we ended up putting a contract on that church. And thinking that it was going to be the place where Life Church would begin, because it looked to us that no one else was interested in purchasing it. And so again, we were pretty much began to be settled with the fact that this would be the place where life would be birthed. But one Sunday afternoon after service, I decided to drive over to the church, and they were finishing up their Sunday morning worship. And once they finished, he came over to me and asked me to come with him to his office. And there in his office, he informed me that he had accepted another offer. I was surprised, because I did not know anyone else again was interested and that there would be another offer. He explained to me that they had accepted another offer and they would be closing soon. And after saying our goodbyes, I got in the car and I called the realtor to inform him of what had happened. And the realtor asked me, he said, Dr. Merritt, are you still encouraged? And I said to him, I said, remember, this is not my idea. This is God's idea. And because it's his idea, he's responsible for providing us with what he's told us that we have to start in. And it would be about 2 weeks later, after hearing the news that that door had closed, about 2 weeks later, a realtor called me to let me know that he had found another property and wanted to set up an appointment for us to go and to look at the property. He gave me the area that the property, the church was in. I was not familiar with that area, or I was not familiar with the name of that community. But I got the address and we set up the appointment, and I met him there at the church. And as I was approaching the church, it became obvious that this area was near an area that I was very familiar with. We drove up to the church, got to the church, and walked in the door. When we walked in the door, I looked at the realtor and I said, this is it. I didn't know any specifics. At the time, it was owned by the bank. It had been foreclosed on. It was owned by the bank. I didn't know what the bank wanted. I didn't know what the criteria were. I didn't know any details, but I did know. I just had this assurance in my spirit that this would be the place. It was just a no-so. And we pursued, made our offer to the bank, and the offer was accepted. And it was at 344 Candler Park Drive, Northeast Atlanta, where all of this began. There, the Life Church was birthed. And so for the first month, they gave us access to the building, and we did renovations and had work done to the exterior, to the interior, the carpet, renovated bathrooms, purchased equipment, musical equipment, and purchased chairs and pulpit furniture and all of the different things, because it was a church building, but it was completely empty. And so we had to update, and then we had to furnish. And for 1 month of constant work going on to that facility, and at the end, we began Bible study there in January of 2010. The last two Wednesdays of September, of January of 2010, we had Bible study those two Wednesday evenings. And then we had our first Sunday morning service the first Sunday in February of 2010. That is where it all began. About 5 or 6 months after starting the church, from the very beginning, we opened up the doors of the church for the first time. Even though we began in February, we didn't open up the doors of the church until March of 2010. The first Sunday we opened up the doors of the church, seven individuals joined, two of which were my parents. Seven individuals that first Sunday in February of 2010. And we immediately put together a new member orientation curriculum, and we began to teach new member orientation to individuals who connected to the Life Church. And so about 6 months after the ministry began, a couple joined the church. And it was in this first lesson, as I was reviewing the beginning of this of the ministry of Life Church, that the young lady raised her hand and asked, was the pastor of the church that we had placed that initial contract on, was his name Superintendent Talley? And I said to her, yes. And she said to me, she said, that is my grandfather. And you must understand that Adamsville is in, again, Southwest Atlanta. The church, the place where we planted and began and birthed Life Church, 344 Candler Park Drive, is in Northeast Atlanta, on the very opposite side of town, that God would allow his granddaughter to come and unite with the Life Church. And after her uniting with the Life Church, not only was she there, but she went back and got all of her family and brought them to the Life Church. And to this day, they are not just yet members of the church, but they are very active, very important and vital part of this ministry. And they have been since that time. And I say that just to say to someone to understand that when God's hand is in something, you can expect to see, amen, the supernatural, and you can expect to see things that could not have happened unless God did it. That was a God thing. That was a sign to let me know that I was right where I was supposed to be, that I was in the will of God, that God would allow something. Some would say that was coincidence, but that is far beyond just coincidence that that would take place. And that was one of the earliest signs that God gave us. And throughout the history of this church, God has given us signs to let us know that this is his doing and this is his will and that his hand is on this ministry. The church began to grow and continued to grow to the point that it became obvious that we were going to need a permanent facility. Our initial property was in a residential area, as I mentioned before, and so consequently there was no off-street parking. All of our parking was on the street. It was a very active community. There were always things going on at the park, festivals going on. Sundays were a very active time around that community, and so parking became an issue. When we first started, parking wasn't a problem because we didn't have cars to park. But as the church continued to grow, parking became a problem, and we knew that that was not going to be a situation that we were going to be able to continue to grow in. So we began to look for a permanent residence. At the beginning of that third year, God spoke to us and said that it would be a year of quick, swift transitions for the good. That was God's word for 2013, a year of swift, sudden transitions for good. And we began a building fund drive as we began to raise money for our future home and for our permanent residence. And I was looking with the realtor, looking at the options that we had in Atlanta as far as church buildings that were for sale. And all of the things now, after these 3 years in Candler Park, the things that we would need in our own facility. And we came across a property, this property here on Stone Road. It also was a foreclosure, we had to interact with the bank who yet owned the property. And we were only 3 years old, and we were coming out of the horrible recession. Atlanta was hit very hard by the recession. Not only was Atlanta hit, but the church world in Atlanta was hit. Atlanta had the highest foreclosure rate of churches anywhere in the country, and so it was the conditions were not favorable to us as a three-year-old ministry trying to purchase a church the size of the one here at Stone Road. This was a 25,000 square foot facility sitting on almost 5 acres of land. And so fortunately, we had professionals who handled our finances here at the church from the very beginning. And so we were in a better position than most churches would be at 3 years, just being 3 years old. And so we put a contract on this church, and the CEO of the bank, a small community bank, again, that owned the church, brought me in to meet with him and the rest of the board. And so I came and met with him and the board, made a presentation, did a financial overview of the church, was positioned to answer any questions they would have. But in the middle of my presentation, the CEO stopped and he said to me, he said, "I've got one question for you." He said to us, said to me, he said, "When can you close?" And I was startled. And not only was I startled, but some of the other board members, it was obvious they were startled also by the expressions on some of their faces. But he asked, "When could we close?" And my response to him was, "When do you need us to close?" And he gave me the date. I believe we had about 15 days or so that he wanted to close on the facility. He said, "And will you be able to make the payment?" I said, "Yes, sir, we will be able to make the payment." And from that, he stepped out on faith with us, and we were able to secure that mortgage for this property. And as we agreed, 15 days later, we closed on this facility. And September 15th of 2013, we marched from the old facility into this new facility, which is currently the home of the Life Church here in Atlanta, Georgia. The Lord's hand has continuously been on this ministry. It is continuously, it continuously grows. About 3 years after closing on the church, a shopping plaza directly across the street became available, and I put it to the church and told them that I wanted to purchase that shopping plaza. And we went ahead, and they agreed, and they joined me, and we closed on that shopping plaza. And so this is not just our only acquisition, but we've also acquired the shopping plaza across the street from the church. We call it the Life Plaza. And we are positioning for new and more acquisitions. We believe that what we are experiencing is just the beginning. This is the place where lives are transformed. This is the place where we make positive impact on this community. We partner with local schools. We are very present in this community. We are blessing to this community. We meet needs in this community, and we're excited about what God is doing. I'll never forget when we first moved to this facility, some of the neighbors who had come by, they said, "There are other churches in the area, but they only have church in our community. They don't really do anything for the community." And I made a promise to them that day. I said, "We will not be the same. You will know that Life Church is here." And that has been our commitment, and we make good on that commitment to ensure that this community knows that we're here by the way that they could feel the impact, feel the hand of the Life Church in this community. We believe that not only does God have a great future for us here at the Life Church, but we believe that He has a great future for this community also. We've been placed here on purpose, and it is our desire to make a tremendous positive impact on this community as we share the gospel, not just in word, but we share the gospel in deed, as we show compassion, and as we, amen, meet the needs of the people in this community. And so here we are, and even now as we're preparing to celebrate 11 years here of our church anniversary, we celebrate our church anniversary every October. We are getting ready to pay off that mortgage on the plaza across the street. And so we currently have two mortgages, one on the main facility where the sanctuary, the primary property is, and then we have a mortgage on the plaza across the street. But in a few days, we're getting ready as we celebrate our anniversary to pay off that mortgage. And so that's just how we do here at the Life Church. We serve a real big God, and we have big faith. And because we have big faith in our big God, God does big things for us. God bless you. We're grateful that you've connected your life to the Life Church. And just know, expect your life is getting ready to change, and it's going to change for the good. We are constantly getting better. We'll never be perfect, but we will continue to be better. God bless you. We love you. And again, welcome to the Life Church.